Do you have a favorite sport? Maybe a favorite team? Well, one day, the most important team in your life may not be the one playing a ball game. It may be the team you're suddenly counting on in a visit to a hospital emergency room or a team of paramedics working to rescue you from a dangerous situation. And there's a lot of science behind making those teams perform better. Put the ball in the net. It's not complicated, but even soccer has rules and strategies of defense and offense.
Runners! Runners!
And it's an international game. So pro players like these Phoenix Rising teammates may be speaking to each other in a language that is not the one they grew up speaking.
I'm Solomon ASANTE. I'm from Ghana. I'm a right winger. I was in Congo, DR. I was playing there. I was there for 5 years, and then the language was French. And this time here around is English. So I'm trying to adapt with everything.
Two touch, same thing.
Sometimes people speak in different languages. They're saying the same words. You understand the word model, but you don't understand what they mean by it.
Yeah, it's difficult sometimes. You know, we have new guys in that have to get used to you.
When it's game time, communication becomes even more important.
We take a lot of measures of what we call team process. How did they interact? How did they communicate? How did they coordinate? And all of those things are relevant for trying to understand how to make teams better.
Teams under pressure, communication. What works, what doesn't, and why? That's what Nancy Cook's research is all about. Cook measures the performance of a group by measuring how effective it is at achieving its goals. Cook works in human systems engineering at the Polytechnic School at Arizona State University. Mm-hmm. Many of her findings come out of this lab, and then they make their way into real-world situations, like the stress on medical and emergency response teams. Situations where the stakes are much higher than just a soccer game. In this scenario, it's a confined space rescue. Victims trapped below street level and possibly exposed to poisonous fumes.
Emergency events are incredibly complex and very high risk and dangerous. So communication is a critical component to their ability to accomplish the mission or to effect a rescue or to recover a body or to secure a hazardous environment. You've got teams from every corner of the valley that can come together on one of these events. So their ability to work interoperable with one another is incredibly important.
We're on scene of a vehicle into a trench.
There's really an initial learning period that has to happen when any team assembles to try to figure out how to talk to one another. And some of the biggest problems teams like that can have are understanding who does what and communication.
Victim one's removed.
This is only training, but even here, first responders know that time counts. Real victims might be injured and even dying.
Good job.
And that can add pressure, conflict, and confusion to their communication.
My research is on teams and has been teams of people. More recently, it's on teams of people and robots and artificial agents working together.
In the future, tools like these may be controlled remotely and work robotically.
The culture in the fire service is very hands-on, very tactile, very much a blue-collar environment. So technology, when it creeps in, can feel like an affront to the way that we do business, right? It's an affront to our skill set. And we like to think that we can get through stuff with the tools that we have.
Soon, it will get easier as research underway at the Polytechnic School at Arizona State University pairs research teams with a popular computer game to simulate emergency rescue situations that will one day allow the first responder to send in a robot when there is danger.
We're looking at human-robot teaming where the robot is inside a collapsed building structure looking for victims, and there's a human on the outside mapping where those victims are. What we're doing in our lab is putting two people together, and it's a Minecraft environment. We use Minecraft to simulate the collapsed building, and we have one person that plays the role of what would be the robot inside the building communicating with the person on the outside.
And let's do the restrooms and the elevators.
It's a challenging problem because the person on the outside might have a floor plan, but that floor plan has changed now that walls are down and doors are down. And so how does the robot on the inside communicate where the victims are to the person on the outside?
Call came in, they found an unconscious victim outside.
You have a group of technical operators that are going down into a space and they're remote from the rest of the crews. So that's the communication there is really, really imperative. And so that stress complicates communication. We talk about how important it is. We talk about ways to communicate with one another to convey a message in a time-sensitive manner or using concise language, things like that to help convey the intent of the command officer, convey the intent of the communicator.
And that's how you can tell the good teams from the bad. We look at how they respond. We look at their communication, their coordination, situation awareness, and the idea is that the research begins and ends in the field. We don't want to ask people to change to be more like robots or to interact better with robots. We want the robots to interact better with the people.
The behavioral science that Nancy Cook can bring to situations like these may help ensure that when it's real life and life or death, nobody working on scene will be the dummy.